Wow, it got quiet in here real fast, didn't it? Holy cow, I didn't even say anything yet. But we're so thrilled to be here this morning on Easter. Happy Resurrection morning to everyone. Yeah. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Amen. Before we do anything else, that's the first thing we should do, is just give God thanks and praise that we can be here. Last year we weren't here. This year we're here in two services. So we'll call this the sunrise service. You know, for you, I want to get up at 9 o'clock or be here at 9 o'clock. We'll call it the sunrise service and then the regular service with the... I'm just so thankful to be here. Honest, I can't tell you how wonderful... I've been up since 4 o'clock this morning. I preached the message already. I don't know where you were. You didn't hear it. But I'm just so glad to see you all. I want to make two announcements. Tomorrow, Monday, we have our men's and women's Bible studies. Women up here, men in the lower level. And then on Tuesday, the seniors start. The senior luncheon starts. And we're gonna have the seniors meet right here in the sanctuary. Okay? Please be careful of all the... If you have coffee or something that, you know, you're sitting on pews. Okay? And that's what we want to announce. But we also want you to keep in prayer the family of our sister Charlotte Hogue's brother who passed away. A tragic event, and we want to just keep them in prayer. Can we do that now? Let's just pray. Father, we don't even have the words to say when someone passes away like that. We just ask you to allow your Holy Spirit to come and comfort. He is the comforter. He can comfort people when we can't, when we don't have anything to say. God, you can come in and touch people's hearts. I pray, Father, that they will be drawn to you, where they will receive that love that you can only give through your Holy Spirit. And so be with Charlotte and Phil and the whole rest of the family, the children, God, who lost their dad. I just thank you, God, that we can support them as a church. As we celebrate today, we know, God, that there's one that's celebrating with you in heaven. And so we thank you, God. Have your way today in our hearts as we worship you. Be the guest here today. Let your Holy Spirit join us today as we dedicate this Easter Sunday morning, this resurrection morning to you. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Let's all stand together, and we're going to worship God together. Amen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing to this, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. He didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. Oh, I could separate.
stars they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon
Yeah! If there are words for him, then I don't have them. You see, my brain has not yet reached a point where it could form a thought that could adequately describe the greatness of my God. And my lungs have not yet developed the ability to release a breath with enough agility to breathe out the greatness of his love. And my voice, you see, my voice is so inhibited, restrained by human limits, that it's hard to even send the praise up. You see, if there are words for him, then I don't have them. My God, his grace is remarkable. Mercies are innumerable. Strength is impenetrable. He is honorable, accountable, favorable. He's unsearchable yet knowable. Indefinable yet approachable. Indescribable yet personal. He is beyond comprehension, further than imagination. Constant through generations, King of every nation. But if there are words for him, then I don't have them. You see, my words are few. And to try and capture the one true God using my vocabulary would never do. But I use words as an expression of worship to a Savior who is both worthy and deserving of my praise. So I use words. My heart extols the Lord, blesses his name forever. He has won my heart, captured my mind, and has bound them both together. He has defeated me in my rebellion, conquered me in my sin. He has welcomed me into his presence, completely invited me in. He has made himself the object of my sight, flooding me with mercies in the morning, drowning me with grace in the night. But if there are words for him, then I don't have them. But what I do have is good news. For my God knew that man-made words would never do. For words are just tools that we use to point to the truth. So he sent his son, Jesus Christ, as the word, living proof. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, giving nothingness formation. And by his word he sustains in the power of his name. For he is before all things, and over all things he reigns. Holy is his name, so praise him for his life. The way he persevered in strife, the humble Son of God becoming the perfect sacrifice. Praise him for his death. That he willingly stood in our place, that he lovingly endured the grave, that he battled our enemy and on the third day rose in victory. He is everything that was promised. Praise him as a risen king. Lift your voice and sing, for one day he will return for us and we will finally be united with our Savior for eternity. Eternity. So it's not just words that I proclaim, for my words point to the word, and the word has a name. Hope has a name. Joy has a name. Peace has a name. Love has a name. And that name is Jesus Christ. Praise his name forever.
Yeah. for the cross. We thank you for the cross, Jesus. We just worship you tonight.
That was spectacular. Let's give him a praise. I don't know what else to say. You may be seated. There's no other way to follow something like that except for you to hear God's word. Because faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. That exhortation, if that didn't stir your soul, you better check your pulse. You were probably dead. What a blessing. Oh, my Lord. It was incredible. Thank you, ladies. Thank you so much. I don't know what else to say. It was just amazing. Just amazing. What does the resurrection of Jesus Christ mean to us today? You know that the fact that Jesus Christ rose from the grave is a historical fact. It's not some religious thing that we believe because we're Christians. But people have spent a greater part of their lives trying to disprove this resurrection day. Men like Lee Strobel, who investigated and wrote from a book and a movie, The Case of Christ. And I think the greatest evidence of trying to disprove the resurrection was written by Josh McDowell in a book called Evidence That Demands a Verdict. And if you ever want to give a book to someone who's a skeptic, you pick up that book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, and see what God does in their heart. You have to make a decision when you read something like that. But you know what? Not only men did this to try to disprove the resurrection and wound up proving it beyond the shadow of a doubt, but it was prophesied. Psalm 16:10 prophesied that Jesus would rise from the dead. Jesus himself prophesied that he would rise from the dead. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 40, it says, "For as Jonah was in the belly of the great fish for 3 days and three nights, so will the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth for 3 days and three nights." And that was the gospel message. That was the message of the early church, that Jesus Christ rose from the grave. The Apostle Peter said in Acts chapter 10, verse 39 and 40, he said, "And we apostles are witnesses of all that he did throughout Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a cross, but God raised him to life on the third day." It says, "Then God allowed him to appear." Do you know how many times he appeared after his resurrection? They say that he appeared at least 13 times after he rose from the grave. And who saw him? There's a list. Listen to this list. Mary Magdalene saw him. The woman returning from the tomb. Paul near Damascus. Stephen near Jerusalem. Peter the apostle. Paul in the temple. The disciples on the Emmaus Road. Over 500 believers at one time in Galilee. The rest of the apostles. A multitude at his ascension. Seven by the lake of Tiberias. John on the Isle of Patmos, James at Bethany. What a list. Over 13 times he appeared. Jesus himself testified that he died and he rose again. Revelation chapter 1, verse 18 says this, "I am the living one," he says. "I died, but look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and the grave." The resurrection, you know what the resurrection proves? The resurrection proves that Jesus is Jesus.
That's what it does. It proves that Jesus is the Savior. It proves that Jesus is who he said he was. It proves that our faith is not in vain. It proves that we have everything to live for. Everything. What does it, but when we think about it personally, what does the resurrection mean to me personally? How does it affect my life this morning? How does it encourage and console my heart? How does it provoke me to good works? How does it convict me and lead to change? Why do we remember the resurrection and meditate on it this morning? Why? Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, Paul said, Timothy, always remember that Jesus Christ, he said, always remember, the word in Hebrew is zakar, remember. It's a pin that I wear that I bought at the Holocaust. Remember, zakar. Zakar means to recall. It means to bring it to mind. And this is what Paul is teaching Timothy. Always remember that Jesus Christ is a descendant of King David. He was raised from the dead. This is the good news that we preach. Why did Paul tell Timothy to remember this? Why does God tell us to remember this? There's good reasons for it. And how it affects the way we live today. And I want to just give you a couple reasons. Is that okay? The first reason is this. The resurrection means that the sacrifice for your sin has been accepted. Romans chapter 4, verse 25. It says this. He was handed over to die because of our sins. And he was raised to life to make us right with God. It's a twofold promise. Number one, Christ was delivered for our offenses, it says. He was handed over to die. That means his death was a reality. His death was a payment for sin. His death made it possible for God to forgive us, and his death had an atoning power to cover sin. Secondly, he was raised again, it says, for our justification. It means, how do we know that Jesus takes away sin? How do we know our sins are gone from our account? Romans 4:25 says, he was raised again for our justification, to make us right with God. So that means that Easter is the seal that Jesus did the job. He did the job. Easter is God's endorsement that his justice has been fulfilled. Easter is heaven's approval that the Father has accepted the Son's payment for sin. Easter is the divine assurance that your justification has been secured. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24 records this. He personally carried our sins in his body on the cross. I love those next few words. So that. He did this so that. We can be dead to sin and live for what is right. Amen? But how do we know God's holy demand was satisfied? Easter declares that Jesus lives. His life is the guarantee of our justification. In other words, Easter proves that God was pleased with what Jesus did. Easter proves that you can now live free from all guilt and condemnation and enjoy the power of a clear conscience. Amen? Amen. Amen. The second thing the resurrection means is this. The resurrection means that you have a sympathetic high priest interceding for you. Amen? Amen. Hebrews 7:25 says, therefore, he is able once and forever to save those that come to God through him. He lives forever to intercede with God on their behalf. Amen. Romans 8:34 says this. Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us. And he is sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us, interceding for us. And how does that encourage you? How does Easter lift our spirits? Because Jesus lived life on earth just like you and me. He knew sorrow and heartache like you and me. He knew pain and infirmity just like you and me. So what's the big deal? What's the big deal? The big deal is when we stand by an empty tomb and realize that Jesus has power over death, then we believe that every issue smaller than death, he is in control of as well. Amen? In other words, if Jesus can deal with death victoriously, which is a greater issue, then Jesus can intercede for every other issue in your life. Every issue in your life, he is your intercessor. He can turn your crosses into your advantage. He can turn your pain into his gain. He can turn your scars into stars. He can give grace greater than every trial, every pain, every loss, and every disappointment. Why? Because he lives forever to be your faithful high priest, and he is touched, the Bible says, with the feelings of our infirmities. A great high priest. And finally, the resurrection means that there is life beyond the grave. And to me, that blows my mind. How many of you are looking forward to a brand new body? Let me see. See, the ones who didn't raise their hand are under 30 years old. You know, I just caught a couple that didn't raise their hand. How many of you could handle the rapture if it occurred today? Yeah, me too. So you know what? You know what Easter means? Easter means that one day the believer will be in heaven with a brand new body.
Amen.
It means that you're not going to be some vague spirit floating around, you know, back and forth in the universe. You know, you're not going to be... I don't like when I see those pictures of angels. You ever see those pictures of angels they show you, those little fat kids, you know, where they got a bow and arrow, you know? I don't want to be a little fat kid. You know, I'm a little fat man now. And you ever see a picture of an angel? I mean, they're awesome. They're awesome, you know. But what it really means is there is a fourfold body change. And I'll get a little technical with you for a minute. In 1 Corinthians 15, it talks about the way the body is going to be changed. And we preach this at funeral services too, because we know that the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, it says the body is sown in corruption, but is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, but it's raised in glory. It's sown in weakness, but it's raised in power. And number four, it's sown a natural body, but it's raised a spiritual body. Well, what does this all mean? What does it mean? It means we're put in the ground, but we will come out of the ground. We're buried out of sight, but will one day be seen again. We're embalmed and we're subject to decay or cremated, but we will be raised with a glorified body. Praise God. Amen. You know what that means to me? That means, in other words, I don't care if it's Gold Gym, Planet 95, Factory Fitness, your exercise bike, your treadmill, jogging, Stepmaster, Thighmaster, Stairmaster, aerobics, sit-ups, push-ups, pull-ups, ab flex, vitamins, and all the health food available, even Slim Fast, Nutrisystem, Weight Watchers, and Jenny Craig, will not prevent us from death, dying, and decay. Now, please don't go around saying, Pastor Sam said we don't have to eat right, we don't have to exercise. No, you should eat right. I should eat right and exercise. That's not what I'm saying. But you know what? What all I said that for? It's not going to prevent us from death, dying, and decay. But that's okay. You know why? Because 1 Corinthians 15, 54 says, death is swallowed up in victory. Swallowed up. And that, you know, the word swallow means four things. It means to absorb, to destroy, to remove, and to abolish. To abolish. The power of death will be destroyed and brought to an end. How do I know that? Because verse 57 says, thanks be unto God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. That means, oh, grave, where is thy sting? Oh, death, where is thy victory? No more aspirin, no more ibuprofen, no more Tylenol, no more doctors, prescriptions, hospitals, ambulance, no more funeral services, medical examiners, death certificates, caskets, no more goodbyes, tears, flowers, cemetery lots to pick out, no more death, no more sorrow, no more loneliness, or widows or widowers. Why not? Because death is swallowed up in victory. It's swallowed up in victory. And we have a promise. That promise in 1 Thessalonians 4:17 says, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen? Amen. Amen. John chapter 5, verse 28 and 29 says, don't be surprised. Indeed, the time is coming when all the dead in their graves will hear the voice of God's Son, and they will rise again. Those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life. Those who have committed, who have continued in evil will rise to experience judgment. Which group will you be in? Which direction will you be going? What road to eternity are you on today? Pastor Santos preached a message about seasons. I read where someone said that there were seven seasons of life. The thrills, the hills, the chills, the wills, the spills, the ills, and the pills. What season are you in? I don't know where I got that from. But on an old English, in the old British cemetery near Windsor Castle, there's a tombstone with this inscription on it, and I had Ron type it out so you can see it too. It says this: pause, my friend, as you walk by. As you are now, so once was I. As I am now, so you will be. Prepare, my friend, to follow me. And then a nearby pastor wrote these two lines: to follow you is not my intent until I know which way you went. Do you know which way you're going? You know, do you live now for things that will outlive you? Do you know beyond a doubt that you are ready to meet the Lord? That's the message. Are you 100% sure that you're saved and stand righteous before God? Are you? This is the time to make that decision. And I'll conclude with this verse. In Mark chapter 16, verse 4, the Bible says that the stone was rolled away. What stone was rolled away? The stone that sealed the door of the tomb where Jesus was buried. Why was the stone rolled away? Most people say that so Jesus could come out. But that is not true at all. John, in his gospel, in verse 19 of chapter 20, said this: that Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them. Peace be with you, he said. In other words, Jesus' resurrected body was independent of doors and indifferent to walls. Jesus' resurrected body was not inhibited by material doors or walls or stones. He walked right through them after his resurrection. That's the kind of body I want. Then why was the stone rolled away? Not so Jesus could come out, but so that inquirers could go in. The stone rolled away was to speak to us. It tells about the entrance to heaven. It tells about the only way to Jesus. Good Friday, the curtain was torn from top to bottom. Easter Sunday morning, the stone was rolled away. It speaks of an open door to eternal life. It invites us to come now and see. It reveals to us that Jesus indeed has risen. The stone was rolled away is inviting us. It wasn't to let Jesus out, but it was to let you in. It says today is the day of salvation. Amen? Give the Lord a hand of praise for his word today. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus.
God sent his son, they call him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone to you, cause I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he lives. How a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, that calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with and then as death,
here we go,
gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory and I'll know he
reigns. Come on, stand and sing it with us. Sing it with us. Come on.
And because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
Forever.
Now everybody's got to come and pick up these pieces because we got another service to do. But what a way to end it, amen? What a way to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is the day that changed the course of history. History has never been the same since this day. Amen? The happiest day, oh, happy day today. Aren't you glad you came to the house of God today? Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you.
The Lord make his face shine upon you today. Be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you. His presence desires to be upon you to give you that hope that we have because of today, because he rose. He gives you a joy that's unspeakable and full of glory. And he gives you a peace that goes beyond human comprehension, that you can be at peace even in this craziness of this world, because it's a peace that comes from God. And he says, allow that peace to guard you. Guard your heart. Guard your mind. When the enemy tries to throw the fiery darts, bring that peace of God, bring the blood of Jesus. And say, no, not today, devil. In the name of Jesus, I have peace. And we give you thanks for all of these blessings that you've given to us today. We thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And all of God's children shouted, amen.
Amen. Amen. Put your mask on. Tell him it was good to be in the house of the Lord on resurrection morning. Amen.
This world has been crying out for hope, for a hero to save us. We long for the